Welcome everybody to 11 o'clock service. We're glad you're here. We're going to start the song. Come now is the time of worship, because that's why we're here. Stand and join us.
Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, if you worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come.
One day every tongue will confess you are God.
One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now's the time. Come, now is the time to
morning and welcome. How are you all today? Everyone have a good Thanksgiving? Okay, I greet you all in the name of the living and loving Lord Jesus, and I welcome you on this first Sunday of Advent. Let us pray together. Stir up your power, Lord Christ, and come. By your merciful protection, save us from the threatening dangers of our sins, and enlighten our walk in the way of your salvation. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Congregation may be seated. You might have noticed all of our beautiful decorations that we put up yesterday. And of course, we also have our beautiful Advent wreath here. One of the best-known customs for the season of Advent is the Advent wreath. The wreath and winter candle lighting in the midst of growing darkness strengthen many of the images we find in the Bible. The unbroken circle of greens represents everlasting life, a victory wreath, and the crown of Christ, who is, of course, the Prince of Peace and the King of Kings. Christians use the wreath as a sign that Christ reaches into our time to lead us to light and everlasting life. The four candles mark the progress of the 4 weeks of Advent and the growth of life. The wreath's evergreen branches lead us to the Christmas tree and to the cross of Calvary. At this time, I would like to invite Mr. David Griffenberger and his family, Molly, Saul, and William, to light the first candle.
Jacob, for you promised to transform weapons of war into implements of planting and harvest, and to teach us your way of peace. You promised that our night of sin is far gone, and that your day of salvation is dawning. As we light the first candle on this wreath, wake us from our sleep, wrap us in your light, empower us to live honorably, and to guide us along your path of peace. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. Amen.
Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light
the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
That is who you are.
And that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Last time.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
So this next song may be new to some of you, but today our readings talk about our eyes being opened, and I could think of no other song that was in my heart to sing. So just join in. After you hear it a little bit, maybe you'll get onto it. Here we go.
Anything can happen. Anything is possible. We could leave it all behind. Could be unstoppable. This could be the first day of the future, the last day of the past. Could it be the start of something greater? Don't let the moment pass. We gotta keep our eyes open. We gotta keep our eyes
Assembly may be seated. At this time, we do have Sunday school today for grades 1 through 4. So Laurencia and Nathan are in the back for the children, grades 1 through 4. Unfortunately, just due to a last minute change, we don't have the pre-K and K class today. But we also do, nursery care is also available for the children below 3. And welcome back, Sean. Did he leave already? In case you noticed on the drums, we're glad to have Sean back, and we can thank him later. But our service will now continue with the reading of the lessons.
The word that Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. It shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of all the mountains, and shall be lifted up above the hills. And all the nations shall flow to it, and many people shall come and say, Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that he may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall decide disputes for many peoples. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. Here ends the reading. Thank you.
The gospel reading for today comes from the gospel according to Matthew, the 24th chapter. Jesus said, But concerning that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son of Man, but the Father only. For as were the days of Noah, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day when Noah entered the ark. And they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away. So will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two men will be in the field, and one will be taken, and one left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken, and one left. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But know this, if the master of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you must also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. And here ends the reading. I would like to begin by thanking Chaplain Jacobs for filling in for me last week. He graciously agreed to share the good news, and it was on very short notice. If you were here 2 weeks ago, you might recall that I mentioned not feeling very well that morning, and my voice was a bit grovelly. Well, it didn't improve after a few days, and unfortunately, Laurencia and our youngest son, Nathan, also came down with it. I thought it was just a cold, but it turned out to be COVID. And so we had to quarantine for a few days. And so thanks again to Chaplain Jacobs. But we are all better now. Hospital has given us permission to be out and about in the general population. But we do appreciate all the prayers and support during the quarantine. There's an old saying that if you fail to prepare, then you should prepare to fail. Have you heard that one before? I remember a teacher who used to tell our class, we're having a test on Friday. The material that we just covered will be on the test. You have been warned. So if you fail to prepare, then you should prepare to fail. That saying reminds me of one of Aesop's fables called The Ant and the Grasshopper. One frosty autumn day, apparently this wasn't at Gitmo, but one frosty autumn day, an ant was busy storing away some kernels of wheat that he had gathered during the summer to tide him over the coming winter. A grasshopper, half dead from hunger, came limping by with a fiddle under his arm. When he saw what the ant was doing, he begged a morsel from the ant's store to save his life. "What were you doing all summer while I was busy harvesting?" asked the ant. "Oh," replied the grasshopper, "I was not idle. I was singing lovely songs all day." "Well," said the ant grimly, "since you sang all summer, it looks as though you will have to dance all winter." Then, as he was closing the door on the grasshopper's sad face, he remembered how much he had enjoyed the grasshopper's singing all summer, and he opened his door again. "Please come in and dine with me," he said, "but I hope you have learned your lesson. Always prepare today for tomorrow's needs." The grasshopper wasn't a bad guy. He just failed to prepare. But thankfully, the ant was willing to bail him out. And I'm sure the grasshopper learned his lesson and didn't make that mistake again. Have you ever failed to prepare for something that you knew was coming? About 10 years ago, I was in seminary at the time, and we drove from Pennsylvania down to Maryland to celebrate Christmas with my parents. We had been planning this trip for several weeks, but I still failed to do a good job of packing my things. We were getting ready to go to church on Christmas Eve when I realized that I didn't have any appropriate pants to wear. All I had were pajama pants and athletic shorts, and no one had a spare pair of trousers in my size. So I had no choice. I had to go to Target on Christmas Eve to buy some khakis to wear to church. On the way to the store, I thought to myself, it probably won't be that bad. Most people have done all their Christmas shopping by now. There'll be plenty of parking. I'll just run into the store, grab some pants, breeze through the checkout, and be back home in no time. As it turned out, I was a little too optimistic. When I got to the mall, there wasn't a single parking spot in sight. I had to drive around for 30 minutes just to find a place to park. When I finally got inside the store, it was complete pandemonium. I could see the panic on people's faces as they struggled desperately to find last-minute gifts on empty shelves. Thankfully, I found some trousers in my size, but it took me almost an hour to pay for them. So I said to myself, the next time I fail to prepare, I'm just wearing pajamas to church. Today, many churches around the world begin the season of Advent. It is the beginning of a new church year, and it is a time of preparation. The word Advent means coming or arrival, and in the New Testament, this word is used to describe the coming of Christ. During the season of Advent, Christians prepare to commemorate the arrival of Jesus in Bethlehem. We prepare for the second coming of Christ when his dominion, his kingdom, will one day replace all worldly rulers and powers. And also during this season, we prepare a place for him in our hearts as individual believers. Even if you come from a tradition which doesn't celebrate the season of Advent, I'm willing to bet that you have nonetheless started making preparations for Christmas one way or another. This weekend, as I walked through the neighborhood, I saw people putting up Christmas lights and decorations. I was delighted to notice the lights on the street lamps and the beautiful tree across from the marina. And while I myself did not go to the exchange for Navy Blue Friday, I was told that it was quite busy with folks shopping for Christmas presents. And as I mentioned, you probably noticed the beautiful decorations here in the chapel. If you fail to prepare, then you should prepare to fail. But I can't help wondering, are we preparing in the right way? Preparing for the Christmas holiday is one thing, but preparing for the arrival of Christ is something else. Many people, some of whom are not believers, will put much time and effort into preparing for the Christmas holiday. Even Christians who worship on a regular basis, who pray frequently, even for them, it can be easy to miss the reason for the season with all the distractions and commotions around us. In this morning's gospel reading from Matthew 24, Jesus tells his disciples that no one knows the day and hour of his arrival, not even Jesus himself, but only the Father. He encouraged them to keep awake and to be ready, because the Son of Man would come at an hour they did not expect. Jesus gave them an example about the importance of being ready. He said, thieves are always out there looking for a home to break into and property to steal, which is why you always keep your door locked. It's not a matter of if it happens, but it's a matter of when it happens, which is why you must always prepare today for tomorrow's needs. Pastor Brian Stoffergen once wrote that as Christians, even though we don't know when the coming of Jesus will be, the fact that he will come is vitally important to our lives right now, in the present. Even though the people in Noah's day didn't know about the coming judgment, they didn't know that the flood was coming, but it still came. This text I read to you from Matthew 24 is not so concerned with describing the future as it is with a call to repentance and discipleship and readiness in the here and now. Matthew 24 asks us the question, who or what is most important to you? What is the top priority in your life today, at this very moment? In the example from Noah, the great sin of the people was not gross immorality or flagrant idolatry. They were not worshiping the golden calf. But they just placed too much emphasis on the normal cares and necessities of life. They were concerned about eating and drinking. And guess what? So are we, right? Especially during Thanksgiving and Christmas and New Year's, our concern about eating and drinking usually increases as we prepare to welcome guests and family members for these great feasts. The people in Noah's day were concerned about weddings. And guess what? So are we. A wedding is usually the most important day in a person's life. Months can be spent planning the perfect day down to the smallest detail. But there is something more important than feasts or weddings. The Son of Man, Jesus, could come. He might show up without an invitation. Jesus could arrive unexpectedly into our lives. What would you tell him? Go away. I'm busy getting this meal ready. Family's coming over later tonight. Or would you say, don't bother me now, Jesus. It's my wedding day. I've got a million things to take care of. Who or what is most important to you now, today? Perhaps the best way for us to prepare for Christmas, perhaps the best way for us to avoid failing to prepare, is by asking ourselves that question: who or what is most important to you now? I'm sure you're aware that it's less than 1 month until Christmas Day, when we will celebrate the birth of our Lord, when we will rejoice in the Word of God made flesh. If you're anything like me, you probably have a lot to do before then. Christmas cards to write and put in the mail, cookies to bake, presents to wrap, lights to hang, arrangements to be made. Plus, we still have work and all of our regular family obligations. The weeks between now and then won't be getting any longer. We still only have 168 hours per week to get everything done. But I wonder, in the midst of all this busyness, can we find a little extra time each day to prepare a place for Jesus? Can we find a little time to reach out to that neighbor or colleague who is going through a tough time and share with them the good news of Jesus and his love. With everything we have going on, with all the busyness around us, will there be a chance for us to put our faith into action by serving those in need? Can we make time to nurture our own faith through prayer and through reading the Bible? Christmas is less than a month away, but Jesus might arrive early. He might come tonight. He might come tomorrow. Will you be ready? Amen. At this time, I would invite the congregation to please rise. And we will continue with the prayers of the church. After each petition, I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and I ask you to respond, hear our prayer. Let's practice just once. Lord, in your mercy. There you go. Let us pray together. As we prepare for the fullness of Christ's presence, let us pray for a world that yearns for new hope. God of all creation, your children everywhere cry out for mercy. Awaken the global church to the urgent needs of our time. Break down barriers of culture and custom and unite people of all faiths in your redemptive and healing work. We thank you for all of our Christian brothers and sisters here at Guantanamo Bay and for the ministry we share together. Lord, in your mercy. God of wonder, the earth's beauty and abundance is your gift. Teach us your ways of sharing resources and caring for life. Guard fragile habitats, preserve the wild places, and protect endangered plants and animals. Teach us to be good stewards of the earth, using no more than what we need for each day. Teach us to share from our abundance with those who are struggling to make ends meet. Lord, in your mercy. God of reconciliation, you judge the nations with righteousness. Send hope, forgiveness, and peace to all places experiencing war, tumult, or hardship. Strengthen the resolve of all who work for an end to conflict. We pray for lasting peace in the land of Jesus' birth, as well as Ukraine, Haiti, and Somalia. Lord, in your mercy. God, our protector, watch over the women and men of our nation's armed forces. Strengthen and safeguard those who are forward deploy, at sea or in harm's way. Especially, we pray for our brothers and sisters on the Comfort as they continue their mission. Bless everyone here at Naval Station Guantanamo Bay, all civilians, dependents, visiting family members and friends, and the migrant community. Lord, in your mercy. God of loving kindness, you desire fullness of life for everyone. Fill those who hunger. Comfort the grieving and attend to those near death. Bring help and hope to any who are sick or in need of any kind of healing, whether it be in body, mind, or spirit. Lord, in your mercy. At this time, I invite the assembly to pray for any other people and concerns, or to give thanks for blessings, either by saying them out loud or in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, we pray for the communities of Chesapeake, Virginia, Colorado Springs, and the University of Virginia as they mourn for those who lost their lives to senseless violence. Embrace the families and communities with your loving kindness and mercy as they recover from these tragedies. Lord, in your mercy, God of promise, your goodness is everlasting. We give thanks for the lives of the faithful departed who now rest in you. Receive into your kingdom all those who now rest from their labors, and comfort those who grieve. Be near to those who experience their first Thanksgiving meal without the presence of loved ones. Wipe away all the tears of those who mourn, and fill us all with sure and certain trust in your promise of the resurrection to eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, God of our longing, you know our deepest needs. By your Spirit, gather our prayers and join them with the prayers of all your children. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And now, brothers and sisters, let us pray together as Jesus taught us, using whichever version of the Lord's Prayer with which we are most familiar. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Congregation may be seated. At this time, we will begin to collect the offering. And while they're collecting the offering, we do have just a few announcements. The first of which is that our brother and friend, Zachary Geitzel, will be beginning a new Bible study in January. There you have the picture. So starting January 8th, you are welcome to join us as we begin a study on Sunday afternoons of the Gospel of Matthew. I'll get mine later. Oh, here we go. Thanks. Also, as always, we are looking for volunteers. We recently had a hang up with the background checks. Which is why some of our volunteers who had recently offered to help out with Sunday school, it was just an issue with the forms. But as always, we're looking for volunteers to help out with any of these jobs. Ushering just means like the offering or passing out the bulletins at the beginning. Worship team members, if you have a voice for singing or other musical gifts, any of these jobs, we're always looking for volunteers to help out with that. So you can always see me or RP2 or one of the other worship leaders. Any other announcements or news to share with the community? Okay. Let us just have a brief word of prayer for the offering. Good and gracious God, we thank you for the many blessings that you have given us for ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. We give back to you from what you have first given us, the first fruits of our labor. We ask, Lord, that you will bless this offering, that it may go to where it is most needed. We thank you for the opportunity to practice generosity, to share with those who are in need. We pray all these things in your holy name. Amen. I invite you to rise for our final song.
You are my vision, O King of my heart. Nothing else satisfies, only you, Lord. You are my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, your presence, my Lord. Oh, you are my vision, you are my true word. I ever with you and you with me, Lord. You're my great Father and I'm your true son. You dwell inside me. Sword for the fight. You are my dignity, you're my delight. You're my soul shelter and you're my high tower. Come raise me heavenward, oh power of my power. Nor man's empty praise. You're my inheritance now and always. You and you only, the first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure, you son. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all. Oh,
heart of my own heart.
Heart of my own heart, whatever befall,
Hallelujah. Have a great week. You guys are dismissed.
What? The order of service.